You know, when I first went into the ministry in 1978 in Meadville, Pennsylvania, and Mary and I started to have babies, I had the privilege of baptizing my children. And as life went on and my children grew up, I had the privilege of presiding over my children's weddings. And then as my children started to give us grandchildren, I've had the privilege, as I did today, of baptizing all of my grandchildren. And one thing all those years that I had always hoped and wished for was to have the opportunity to mentor someone and get them ready to pastor their own church. And that happened with Nick. So I guess now I can die. And die happy. This is an ending in a way, but it's also, as you know, a wonderful beginning for Nick and Jessica. And so here's our last opportunity to hear him officially here at TFMC, and we count it a privilege. But I need to read the scripture first.
Don't worry about it.
All right.
It's all good. Okay. Well, anyone have a song memorized? Any song? Just raise your hand. I do. I have a few Beatles songs memorized. Anyone know shows where you know the characters inside and out to the point where you've analyzed what are they going to do next? Walking Dead. I admit that. I love the zombie stuff. We all kind of have stuff that we consume, media. We have movies, we have shows, we have stories that we tell each other, we have fairy tales we learn when we're children, and we have music where stories are said in songs, and we know them, and we memorize them, and it's in our head, and it's almost in our heart, to the point where sometimes when we watch it or hear it, we'll cry. At least I do sometimes. Certain movies just hit me. Braveheart's one of them. Well, sometimes I wonder how many Christians have the same kind of energetic love for the Bible. You see, today's message on a fundamental level is what I learned in, Sunday school. That's this. It's real simple. B-I-B-L-E, that's the book for me. Who doesn't know that expression? A lot of people know that expression. But now that I'm 33, and I'm no longer 7, I understand that expression on a whole nother level, not just in here, but in here. And I want to pass that along to you. I thought of what's the best way of sending off, and Pastor Don kind of questioned it when he first saw the info I gave him, like, old school values, that's the name I gave the, you know, if you're going to talk about the Bible, that's going to be your send-off message. It doesn't even jive with Thanksgiving. And I'm like, yep, that's it. I said it with gusto. That's right. And you'll see why. Anyways, it's real simple. B-I-B-L-E, that's the book for me. So let's get into that. Let me read you today's passage. It's in the red lettering on your bulletin. It says, do good to your servant, and I will live. I will obey your word. Open my eyes that I may see wonderful things in your law. I am a stranger on earth. Do not hide your commands from me. My soul is consumed with longing for your love, for your laws at all times. Now that I read that, let me go and read the first part over again, okay? Now, it says laws, but we're going to apply this entire message to the whole Bible, okay? All the laws, from the Torah, which is Genesis through Deuteronomy, all the way up into the book of Revelation, which is the laws of God. Let me read the first part. Do good to your servant, and I will live. I will obey your word. Open my eyes that I may see wonderful things in your law. He wants to live. Now, the question I have, real simply, what do we live for? That question is really easy to answer. Because if you go to a funeral, you don't hear people saying, oh, I really miss the truck that they owned. Do you? That sounds really shallow, doesn't it? I really miss how they played Monopoly. They were always stealing the money in the house. No, we don't do that. We say we miss them. We miss people. What we usually live for is love. We live to love. It's the way we're built. And if it wasn't, then why do we all get married? At least those of us who do. And why at funerals do we all say we missed them as opposed to just the stuff that they owned or a certain personality? No, we miss them as a whole. Why? Because we as human beings are built to love. Now, the reason I bring that up and what that has to do with the Bible is this. God, according to the Bible, is, definitionally speaking, love. God is love, said John the Apostle. And if that's the case, if God is love, then the question is it really about the people that God created, or is it about the God who created them? In other words, you miss a person because you want love, but who's the one that gave you love in the first place? Who's the one that gave you your spouse in the first place? Who's the one that gave Julian to Jonathan and Valerie in the first place? God the Creator. We live to love, but God is love. So the question I have is, how do you relate to God? You relate to God by the Bible. B-I-B-L-E. Now, a lot of people don't understand the Bible. I'm going to get into that later in this message. We'll get into that. I'll kind of teach you a few things to try to help you get into the Bible more. But the one way in which we relate to the God of love, and we're built in order to love and connect with people, is by the Bible itself. In fact, if you read the language, it starts out with, do good to your servant, that is, let me live. It says, and I will live. And then the very next word says, I will obey your word. It goes from, my life is saved, to, I can now obey your word. In a real sense, according to the psalmist, we literally live in order that we can obey God's word. Jesus himself said in the New Testament that man cannot live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from God's mouth. It's not just about filling our stomachs, but about filling our souls in the core of who we are. Now, the second point I want to make is kind of the reverse of that. And you'll see that. Let me read it. It says, I am a stranger on earth. Do not hide your commands from me. Now, you know, I've faced that before. Before I was married, I had to face loneliness. I had loneliness. I was a single guy. I wanted to get married, you know. I didn't dream about my wedding all my life. I hear usually women do that, but whatever. I didn't do that, but I still wanted a partner. You know, I kind of read the stuff you read about Adam where God said, it's not good that man's alone and he provides Eve. I wanted my Eve. I wanted someone to connect with because I'm built to love and to be loved. And so that's what I asked for. But sometimes people don't necessarily get that right away. I didn't get that right away. I married a bit late. And so I had to face loneliness. We on this earth, because we are built in such a way as to receive and give love, and that's what life's all about, we therefore have to face what it feels like to be alienated and to be estranged on this earth when we have a fallout with someone that we used to love. It's so easy to get into a mode of being a stranger on this earth. I have faced it. I guarantee almost everyone in this sanctuary has faced the feelings of being estranged from people, from society. You kind of feel alone. But the reason you do is because of how you're built. But what's interesting, it says, I'm a stranger on earth. Do not hide your commands from me. In other words, when we feel alone, God provides the need we have for love by giving us his commands. So if you want to say that the first point is real simple in that we live in order that we can obey God's laws, the second point is the reverse of that. We live because of God's laws. It's almost like circular reasoning, but not really. What it is the Bible connects us to the God of love to the point where he's not only the source of our being, but he is what we are going to every time we reach out to someone. We're really reaching out to God in our heart. St. Augustine, who was a a church father in the fourth century talked about having a hole in your heart, and only God can fulfill it, not even a human being. But human beings are made in the image of God, so every time we reach out to marry a human being or to be a friend with a human being, our heart is reaching out to God. Even atheists do that. Their minds may not know that they're reaching out to God when they reach out to other people, but their hearts are. Everyone's heart is a Christian heart. And what is that? A heart that reaches out to God himself, even if their mind doesn't understand that. It's the way we're built, because we're built to what? Give and receive love. Now, let me take this, and let me, you probably understand this at this point. Okay, he's a preacher, he's talking about the Bible, and it's built based upon who we are. We want to connect with God. God is love, and he's somehow tying this in with the Bible itself, because the Bible helps us relate with God. Well, let me give you a real hands-on understanding of how important the Bible is. Let me first read, though, the very last part of the passage. My soul is consumed with longing for your laws at all times. My soul, the very essence of my being, the core of what's inside me, is consumed at all times with your laws, with the Bible. Give me a raise of hand if you have that same experience right now. Okay, and you know what? I'm glad some people didn't. Because not every Christian has that experience. We don't. We have to grow. And at some point in our Christian walk, when we're kind of like toddlers in our Christianity, we do not have a soul that wants to consume the Bible at all times, especially when we don't understand a lot of parts of the Bible, especially in the Old Testament. So I can understand that. But the desperation that you hear in this verse is something that you will eventually grow into. And you'll see why. This past week, I was housebound. The entire week, there was snow everywhere. I was one of the South Towns people. I didn't even know if I was going to make it. This guy calls me up, I think around Tuesday, and says, I'm guessing that by Saturday, Sunday, you're not going to be able to be here. I'm like, I'm guessing the same thing. And we talked about it. And it's like, crud, I won't be able to go to my cousin's wedding. I won't be able to, like, you know, whatever plans I had, it's not going to happen, right? So I was housebound by the snow. Snow's, you know, certain parts, wherever the drifts are, it's really, really high. And, you know, we were saved. My mom and my sister drove out, spending a couple hours on the road, just getting to our area. And they got us after we had dug out a very narrow road in order to get out to the road, you know? And it was tiring. And during that time, the amount of desperation I had wasn't climaxed, but I'm going to be honest with you. Because I learned something about carbon monoxide poisoning and what that can do to a human being, you know, kill them, I had to make sure the pipe at the house was not covered up by snow. I didn't know where that was. I had to call up my dad. My mom gave me advice. Well, I'm not a house owner, okay? I just, you know, I have a lot to learn about house maintenance and stuff like that. So I learned something, and I went in the basement, figured out where the pipe was, went outside, took me a little bit just to get to it. It was hilarious. Jessica puts a video on Facebook. Look at that short man going through the snow. And, you know, it was tiring, you know, and you feel like there's 30-pound weights on your feet when you're going through that much snow. But we cleared the pipe. There was no poisoning. Everything was good. And, of course, I'm here today not dead. Right? But when I was shoveling out, me and Jessica were both shoveling out the path to the road, I was looking beyond the into the road, and I could see these Town of Tonawanda plows going down the street, and I'm like, those are my boys representing me and West Seneca. There you go. I love it. I was so proud. I'm like, there's Tonawanda trucks helping us out. I'm in West Seneca now. And there was also, you know, payloaders, there was construction equipment, and I realized how heavy the snow was. I didn't think that anyone that had a plow could really lift up that snow or get rid of it. Wayne, our deacon here, tells me that, you know, if you chip away at it, you kind of can, but it takes a lot longer. But at the same time, it was a lot of heavy snow, and I needed a lot more equipment to be able to, you know, get the snow out of there. I didn't even have a snowblower. So there came a moment, I didn't tell Jessica, it just hit my head. I'm looking out at the road. There's this equipment going down the road. I'm like, I want me one of those. You know, I want that gigantic snowblower that looks like it could chop a human being in half if you just go in it. But it's gigantic. It's getting rid of. I want one of those. I don't have the money to afford one of those, and they're usually owned by the government. But boy, would it be great. I don't even have a measly snowblower, let alone that. We have a couple of shovels. She's got a lighter shovel. I got a kind of a heavier one. And we're just going away at it, chipping away at the snow, little by little. And it's tiring. And I felt desperation. Not just because of making sure that we weren't poisoned to death, but also because we wanted to get out to the road and have an opening to see civilization, you know? The road in front of us, which was only less than 30 feet or so. And at that moment, at this point, I realized that sometimes you need more equipment. You need better equipment to handle a storm. In life, we'll provide enough storms where the only available equipment that will do the job is this. This is the payloader, the construction equipment of life. This is the only thing that will do the job to the point of the in here. Your core is made in a way where you're supposed to relate with humans in a love-oriented fashion, a give and take. You give love, well, they give love back, but you end up taking it, thankfully. And only this will be able to get you that, because this is your access to the God who is, definitionally speaking, love himself. This is the equipment we need. I realized that real quick how helpless, powerless, weak, little, nothing I am. I'm already a short man. But in general, no matter how big a man or woman is, the amount of snow I faced was an assault. It was horrible. And I felt absolutely assaulted. We all did. We all did in the South Downs. And the only thing that could handle it is the big equipment. That's what the Bible is to a Christian. That's what the Bible is to everyone, because it's by the Bible that we gain access to the God who made us the way he did, who wants to relate with us. Now, someone might say, okay, well, I don't know how to interpret the Bible. I go into the book of Ezekiel and I see flying wheels in the sky with fire all around those wheels and angels with six wings total. And it's like, what does this all mean? I understand that. Well, I'm going to give you one bit of advice to help you how to actually take the information I'm giving you and apply it. Number, before we go to the Bible itself, let me just say the first bit of advice is go out and rent the movie Book of Eli. If you can handle a semi-violent movie, okay, you'll see what I'm talking about. In that movie, Denzel Washington's character plays a character that is led by God to make sure that at the end of the world, the Bible is set over into California, and that those who had a big library over there are able to actually write it down, because that was the last Bible left on earth. And the amount of value held of the Bible you see throughout the movie. In other words, the people in that movie have the same kind of stuff that you see in the Psalm. My soul, not just my stomach, not just my mind. My soul is consumed with longing for your laws at all times. That's what that character's soul is like. But the question is, how do we actually understand the Bible? Well, this is probably the most simplistic advice I can ever give anyone. You learn the Bible the way you learn human language. So simple. When you're a little baby, Julian just got baptized, right? Does he know English yet? No, he doesn't know English. Valerie and John are sitting there talking English back and forth. Julian doesn't know any of that right now, you right? Someday he will, after what, 2.5 years? Right? You spend enough time hearing a language in its own, in the flesh, you get used to the terms, the nuances, the idiosyncrasies, the ways that people talk to each other. That's the same way with the Bible. You have to literally open it up and read it. Even if you don't understand it, like an infant, you just keep going. It doesn't matter if you don't understand it. You eventually will. And guess what? You know, a lot of people in this church have said, well, thank you for your knowledge, boy. You've been at seminary, educated. But when I go to certain parts of the Bible, like Ezekiel, I'm like, oh my gosh, my head's spinning. Still, I have all these good tools, but I read Ezekiel, I read certain parts of Isaiah, and I'm like, oh, okay. I'm going to have to read this at least 25 more times before I really catch the grasp of what's being said. So we're all in the same boat, and that is we're all infants, and we need to spend some time listening and hearing and reading the Bible. Now, a lot of people don't like to read. I know that. My brother's one. My dad is one. I have cousins like that. I know tons of people that just don't like to take paper, open it up, and read a bunch of symbols where the information is taken into here. I understand that. Well, guess what? There's other ways of consuming it. You know, I talked about listening to a song at the beginning of this message. Well, we have the technology at this point to hear the Bible audio in your ears. About 10 years ago, I bought the Bible on CD, and I still have it. I still listen to it. I'll pop in a CD in my car, and sometimes I won't know. I'll know where I'm going, but sometimes I don't understand it right away, and I'll keep listening to it over and over again. And I finally get some of it, right? Other parts, I know it real well. But the point that I'm making is I spend time in it just like a little infant spends time hearing the language of their parents. And when you do that, whether it's reading with your eyes, hearing with your ears, or whatever, like, you will eventually get it. And even if after 25 times you don't, you'll possibly catch the heart of what's being said, even if you don't know all the details. B-I-B-L-E, that's the book for me. Why is it the book for me? It's so simple, because sometimes the most powerful equipment will do. There's going to be a lot of storms in life that you will face. Life ain't easy. Jesus, in fact, promised. He said, when the storm comes, that's what he said. And then he said, build your life on my words. Build your life on my words, because they are like a rock that will not be moved. And if that's the case, if this is like a rock that will be not be moved, then even if we don't understand it, let's at least approach it. And when you do, the moment you do, you will start to gain more of a hunger and a thirst, to the point where you will be able to say, oh, my soul, it's consumed with longing for your laws at all times. Let's pray. Father, I ask in Jesus' name that you please help every one of us, whether we've been reading the Bible for years, or whether we haven't read any ounce of the Bible but have only heard preachers talk about it. I ask in Jesus' name that you please help us to value it enough to realize that it's the only equipment that will do for the human heart. In Jesus' name, amen. Seeing it's Thanksgiving, I want to say thank you to Jesus Christ. I'm so thankful for him. I also thank you all. It's been an honor. And I'm also thankful for this. I've been preaching about it today. And on that note, I just want to share one more thing with you, and then you won't have to hear me preach for a long time. So this is from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 6. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. And on that note, do it. It's worth it. You'll love it. It'll consume your heart. Have a wonderful day. God bless.